Paul, who worked with the president on the order and spoke at today's signing. He even got a pen, I think. Senator Paul, both you and President Trump hammered President Obama for using executive orders while president. Here's an example of you saying it in 2013.
There are several of the executive orders that appear as if he's writing new law. That cannot happen. I'm afraid that President Obama may have this king complex sort of developing, and we're going to make sure that it doesn't happen.
Republicans didn't have the votes to repeal and replace Obamacare legislatively. Why should the president be allowed to do it with the stroke of a pen if it was wrong for the previous president to do so?
Well, you know, I think the courts were pretty clear that President Obama, in trying to rewrite the immigration law, was overstepping his bounds and was acting in a way as to create new legislation. You have to look at the specifics here. This is a law that was written in the 1970s that allows companies to buy insurance across state lines and people who have a nexus, basically some sort of nexus related to their employment. We've read the original law, and we believe what the president did today is basically an interpretation of the original law and doesn't create new territory. The other thing about this is we're creating something that is freedom. He's not creating a new government program. There's no government expense to this. And under the First Amendment, there is a clause that says we have the right to peaceably assemble. That has been taken over time to be the right of free association. And it's also been said by the Supreme Court to actually say that we can join together for economic purposes. So all we're doing today is legalizing the ability of individuals to join a group to try to get better purchasing power. I think it's sort of fundamentally American what we're advocating, and it has the chance to allow millions of people to get insurance at a less expensive rate.
The National Association of Insurance Commissioners responded to today's order, saying, quote, expanding association health plans in a manner that reduces consumer protections or solvency requirements that promote safe and sound markets. We also have concerns about the impact of such a proposal on already fragile markets, unquote. Are those concerns unfounded?
Well, I think you'd have to ask the employees that work for Microsoft, Pepsi, Coca-Cola, Amazon, Amgen. They all get theirs across state lines through the large group ERISA exemption. So we already have dozens and dozens. In fact, half of the people in the insurance market currently get theirs through an ERISA plan. But basically, it's biased for big corporations. What I'm simply trying to say is, why don't we let the little individual, the plumber, the baker, the accountant, the small doctor or attorney, let them join together in association so they can have the same buying power that the big corporations have? But, you know, really the people who are critics of this need to explain why large group ERISA plans that are allowed for big corporations seem to be pretty good insurance. In fact, that's what most of us really are jealous of. If we work in a small business, we wish we had the insurance of a big corporation. So, no, I think there's nothing but good that could come of this. The individual market is really sick under Obamacare. It was sick before Obamacare and requires these subsidies year after year after year, and still the premiums go through the roof. This is an avenue or an exit for individuals to flee the individual market and get what everybody seems to want, which is a good group insurance plan.
There was an interesting moment today during the signing of the order, the president specifically referencing your support for his action. Take a listen.
And I can say, when you get Rand Paul on your side, it has to be positive. That I can tell you. Boy. Rand.
President Trump spends a lot of time looking at you, trying to win over your votes. It's no secret the White House is also seeking your support on the budget and on tax reform, which right now you don't support. Tell us where you are on that.
Well, it's not that I don't support them. I just have some questions. And I think the best way to have questions about legislation is before they become finalized. On the tax cut, I'm all in for the tax cut. I'm all in for reducing the tax burden. I just want to make sure that there is a tax cut for the middle class. And so as it's been presented so far, there is some concern. I brought those to the president, and he told me without any pulling any punches, and he told his staff gathered there that he won't sign it if it's not a tax cut for the middle class. That is heartening to me, but the devil's still in the details. But they've shown an openness to working with me on this. The middle income, those who make between $75,000 and $300,000, middle and upper middle income, the rate is 25%, but we're going to get rid of two big deductions. If you get rid of two big deductions and keep the rate the same, most people would conclude, wow, sounds like some people's taxes are going to go up.
Absolutely.
So that has to be looked at. They are looking at it, and this deal is not set in stone yet. my goal is that I do want to vote for a significant reduction in the burden of taxes on businesses and individuals, but it needs to include a significant cut for the middle income, and it can't raise their taxes. I think they're aware of that, though, and I think it's not really an adversarial process. It's that the president and I are on the same side, and we're just trying to make sure that those number crunchers that are putting it together don't mess it up.
All right, we'll have you back to talk more about it when we see more details. Republican Senator Rand Paul of Kentucky,
thank
thanks
you.
For your time, as always. Over 400 people.